So, today we are here to discuss a specific topic. So this is one of the topics that we wanted to address with these European Research Nights event. And today's topic is gender equality in research and in research careers and NGO careers. To give a short introduction to one European point of view of the issue, I would like to introduce the EU policies, actions, also some of the statistics that are available and that are interesting regarding this specific topic. Before actually going on to the subject, I would like to say that definitely from a, let's say, social balance point of view, it is, I would say it is a good objective to have research teams that should be, let's say, 50-50, gender balanced. However, you can also see that from another point of view. That would be the point of view of maybe the policymaker or the people who are behind the funding of research programs. That is that basically if you have more diversity in a research team, you have better results. So these are just a couple of quotes from scientific publications that try to show that this aspect is true. It's quite well known now that the scientific performance of a team that is multinational is better than one that is just composed of people from the same country and same culture. And it seems that it actually is also the case. Might seem obvious, but it's worth trying to prove it. It seems that it's also the case for gender diversity. So a couple of things that I want to stress today is, first of all, I think that many people are looking for statistics and data on, gender equality status in research careers. And, well, at least in Europe, or in many countries of the EU, these statistics exist, and although I didn't say it before, right on the table outside of the event, you have a few copies of what we call the SHE figures, edition 2015, so the most recent edition actually. And these are quite comprehensive, they feature quite comprehensive statistics about all of the aspects that we could think of regarding gender equality in research careers, once again, in Europe. There's a lot of text here. Unfortunately, since this is not exactly my specialty, I will have to read at some point. Sorry for that. But yes, so SHE figures, it's a European Commission statistics report. It has been done every 3 years since 2003, and as you can see, the latest one for now is 2015, so there should be one coming this year. Some highlights from the 2015 edition are that there are tendencies to a better balance in very early careers, so actually late education, however you prefer to call that, so let's say master and PhD degrees. However, there are still a lot of discrepancy between men and women. So for example, on average, EU 28, I suppose, because this is 2015, only 33% of researchers were women, on average, once again. Depends from country to country. also not only researchers as a whole, but top-ranking positions, so executive level, maybe professorship level, women tend to be underrepresented. One thing that I saw that was also quite interesting was the ratio of part-time to full-time contracts. So 7% of men and 10, well, almost 11 percent for women. And also pay gap. Even though in the full report it pretty much stresses the fact that the pay gap in research and education is much less than what it is in other fields, it is still almost 18%, which is quite high, let's say. So these are a few highlights. What you see here is the ratio of female researchers per field here, and in 2 years, 2005-2012, and the list of countries, first of the EU28, and then some associated countries as well. I will not go over all of them, but what you can, I'm not sure if you can see all the numbers because it's quite small, but there's also a color code. So the more blue it is, the more male, and the more orange, the more female. And when it's whitish, it's pretty much balanced. So, I mean, easy to say that natural sciences, engineering are quite male, engineering quite a lot, actually, because it's so blue. You have some interesting things happening here with the medical sciences. So a lot more female representation in medical sciences. You have somewhat a better balance also in humanities and social science, even though still you can see discrepancies from a country to the other. You have a few points here that may be a little bit less representative, not so sure, because they are small countries, so is the total number of researchers representative enough, statistically speaking? Is this just a bias, or is it not? It might be, it might not be, but what you can see, though, is that Northern European countries and some Northeastern also European countries tend to have higher representation of female researchers, which is quite interesting. This is another graph or table rather, extracted from the same document, She Figures 2015, looking at a publication as a corresponding author for female researchers. So this is the ratio of female to male, female to male corresponding authorship in publications between 7 and 9, so 07, 09, and 2011, 2013, same fields here. So natural sciences to humanities. And well, overall, 31% of publications have a woman as corresponding author. So you could say that somewhat it agrees quite well with the number of researchers. However, there is, it seems there is a difference in the way that researchers and people in higher education are counted in this case, and so people who submit publications or who write publications, scientific publications, may not have been counted under researchers. This you would have to read the whole report to really understand that. So one thing that is interesting is that the average ratio of women to men authorships is 0.5. So half time less publications. However, the ratio of female working in research higher education is 0.7. So you would expect more publication by women, actually. And this is not the case. And once again, the report clearly stresses the fact that it's not underlining a lesser productivity of women versus men, but, and this is where you would have to read the whole report, rather, it is that even though contributing to the work, they might have less chances to be selected or put as corresponding author. Also because even though here you see 31%, 33%, the women in top positions are actually much less numerous. So this is interesting. You have, I think the full report is something like 200 pages long. So if you're interested in statistics, you should take a look at it. The PDF is available online. The presentation will be sent anyhow to everyone. So you'll have the links at the end. And also we are taped. So, okay, now that you have statistics and data, maybe it would be interesting to see what kind of measures you can have to counter whatever effects there might be. And so today what I will discuss is actually measures, or rather incentives, or let's say suggestions from the European Commission that come from a document that's right here from 2012. So measures or suggestions have three different objectives. Raise the participation of female scientists, quite obvious, but also gender balance in decision-making, so that's more addressing the women in top position issue. And also, and that's quite interesting, integrate the gender dimension in the research programs, actually. So we'll see how this works. And to achieve these, there are three levels. So the levels of stakeholders, that is research organizations, member states, so countries, and the European Commission level. This is all quoted from this document, so once again, if you're interested in this kind of policy, you should also check that. First level, research organizations should or are invited to, let's say, to draft gender equality plans, so that can mean try to identify biases in selection committees, for example. But also the other way around, so not only repression, but also incentives. So it could be providing an environment that is better working for women, researchers. And set targets. This is also something that is quite important to have deliverables and be able to monitor the progress. At the member state level, it's more on the legal and policy side, so to ensure that policy-wise there is no or at least there is no easy way onto discrimination, for example. And this is, this is the target, but target 40% of women in, say, top-level positions, so recruitment committees, drafting or evaluation of the funding programs. And that the European Commission, the actions are to support the stakeholders, the member states, in these action points, and to integrate this gender dimension in the funding programs that are within Horizon 2020. So this is what we'll see now. Horizon 2020, I'm sure many of you already know what it is. It's the framework program for research and innovation of the European Union, 80 billion euro from 2014 to 2020. What else? Yes, and international collaboration programs. And even though it is 80 billion, it's only 7% of the total of funding that is available all around Europe for research and innovation. But it's a flagship program. Oh, there's an issue here. It's a flagship program, and it funds from fundamental science to applied research. So, in Horizon 2020, the gender equality aspects are implemented in two ways. The first one is to ensure that in research teams there is at least the best gender balance. And so this is done by, at the proposal stage, institutions who write the proposal have to indicate the gender of the principal investigators with an S. At the evaluation stage, it's not exactly what you would call positive discrimination, but if the two proposals end up with the same score, the one that is more gender balanced gets the funding. At the grant agreement stage, every grant agreement between institutions that will perform the research subject also have to take care about the equal opportunities, gender balance in the recruitment process, if there is one. And same thing in the reporting side at the end or in the middle of the project to check or to monitor if everything is implemented correctly. So this is on the research team side. But it's also important to stress out that some research topics, and not only humanities or social sciences that directly address the gender equality issue, but some project that might be technological advancement, some things that might have an impact on society could benefit from a from looking into a gender aspect as well. So, once again, proposal stage, evaluation, grant evaluation, grant agreement, reporting. Proposal stage, whenever it is relevant that a gender analysis takes place, it should be taking place. At the evaluation stage, this will be taking into account under the criterion of the excellence of the project. If some of you have already touched upon a bit the Horizon 2020 proposal system, every proposal is evaluated with three criteria: excellence, impact, and implementation. And so this is under excellence. Whereas, obviously, these kind of aspects will be more under implementation because it's the team. And so grant agreement, once again, in between the institutions that perform the research, this aspect must be clearly stated as an action plan or several action points. And definitely in the reporting as well, reporting has to take place on these action points. So I just took an example actually today from the latest work program of the of Horizon 2020. This is just an example. It seems to me like an interesting topic, gender perspective of STI in dialogue with third countries, so countries outside of Europe. Project will investigate how gender equality matters, taking into consideration at different levels of international cooperation in the area of STI. And it will actually open this year and deadline in April next year. So this is just an example, because if you go to the portal that lists all of the calls for Horizon 2020, that is called Horizon 2020 participant portal, you have you can find research topics and you can sort them with filters. and one of them is gender, just gender. And I did it this morning, and it was so there were 325 close or past projects. So you can also check the project reports, for example. 45 open calls, so you could apply now, and 67 forthcoming, that is until 2020. Well, so there's quite a lot of projects that specifically mention the gender aspect. And as I just said in the previous slide, this doesn't mean that in other projects it doesn't have to be, in other calls it doesn't have to be addressed. It can be addressed whenever it is relevant, but these are calls where it is specifically mentioned that it should be addressed. Right? Yes, maybe one last slide, because I think I was much too long already, is something a bit more positive, maybe, to finish. So this is actually from a document that was just released last month by the European Commission, that you can find here. That says that, that shows a bit the evolution of the topic. So what they call grade A position is I should have corrected, that is what I would call top level positions. So from 15% in 2000 to 23.5 in 2014. I don't think we have enough point to see if there's a tendency to flat out or not. Not the easiest thing to do. Still, it's a nice progress in 15 years. Heads of education in higher education. So, same thing, a positive evolution, 15 to 20%. Heads of institution that delivers that deliver PhD, 9% to 15%. That is still very low. That is still very low, in my opinion, but it's increasing. So let's see things from the positive point of view for one slide just. And also some evolutions on the legal framework. Actually in 2016, the member states of the European Commission and also associated countries were asked to submit what they call national action plans towards gender equality in research careers. And out of, I think, 24 submitted, maybe 29. And out of the 24, many had, you know, additional or new measures for gender equality, but more specifically 14 member states and 3 associated countries had implemented targets with numbers, which is much more concrete than just measures. So this is also, I would say, somewhat positive. This is all what I wanted to survey for the